Today we are talking about my skis. Let's see here. Get this angled right. Alrighty. Wonder if anybody else is gonna come in. Got some new wax today, a new applicator, and a new removal spray. And I'm gonna see, this is tear off strapper. Okay, so I put this here and tear it off. Strange. Okay. Well, I guess I'll go over the my boots here. Maybe. So the other day, went out and I got some new boots for my skis, the toe clip style, and they are Rosinal X2 Touring. I have a really big foot, so they are size 13s. They have a draw cord in here for quick lacing, and a zipper. So they're waterproof on the outside. They actually keep your foot just the right temperature. They have a nice little pull tab on the back here. Slip on and off really easy. They're actually really easy and nice to walk in too when you're not on your skis. Feel just like regular shoes. So that's good. Yeah. And then they cost $129.95. Pretty expensive. Who's in there? Raw Pride. Hey, how's it going, buddy? So, alright. So, basically the skis that I use are Rosinal. The boots I bought myself for $129 recently, but the skis I've got right here, these are Rosinal skis, waxless cross-country skis. So they are, see if I can show you the information on them right there. I don't recall how much these were because these were given to me via a sponsorship when I was going to school for my outdoor recreation degree. My sponsorship paid for all my ski equipment and everything. So I don't remember how much these were. But they are also, they were purchased in 2012, so the prices have greatly changed since then. But they're still in pretty like new condition. There's couple of scratches on them here and there, but basically they still work really good. So they have the toe clip in, little toe clip right there. You just step in it, and they work real nice. And then you just put your ski pole in right there to pop it back out. Pretty cool. Because I have Parkinson's, it's really hard for me to, when a normal person walks, they swing their arms like this. And when you have Parkinson's, it affects your right-hand side. So your right-hand side tends to stay there, and your left-hand side works like this. So skiing requires you to move back and forth like this, and therefore forces me to use my right side. And the more I can use my right side and be active with my right side, I can stave off the effects of Parkinson's and hopefully go extend my ability to have control and motion and feeling and stuff in my right side. So skiing is a big part of staying healthy and active in a normal person's life, but in a person's life with Parkinson's disease, it actually helps ward off brain death and whatnot. So that's cool. My one of my favorite pair of skis here is the Marquette Backcountry Ski. And these aren't the first set I showed you was a cross-country ski, and these are backcountry skis. Cross-country skis are generally go like on trails and stuff, whether they're groomed or ungroomed, they're kind of for trails. Backcountry skis like this one, they float like a snowshoe, but they can glide like a regular ski at the same time. But then they can also work as a downhill ski. So they're kind of like a crossover of everything. They have, I think you see that, really good waxless grip on the bottom. And so they're great for going uphill or if you just want to walk. And they can attach, if you take this binding off here. Get this off here real quick. There we go. Get the binding off here. You see that you can attach pretty much any kind of binding you want to it. This one's sort of a 3-pin binding, but if you remove it, there's a whole bunch of other holes in here and configurations in the ski itself, so you can put pretty much anything you want on. The kind of binding I have on here, I lucked out. I don't believe they make them anymore, but they are Karu, and they allow you to wear any kind of boots you want. So you can just wear just a regular everyday hiking boot or tennis shoe or whatever you want in here. It doesn't have to be a ski boot. And that's what's really cool about the bindings that I have on here. And they're quick release. They ratchet down. Let's see if I can get this in there. A lot easier to put on when you're wearing them. There you go. Once you click it in, just click this here, ratchet it down to tighten it up. Same thing with the front toe clip. And then you have the Velcro top part for the top part of the belt, of the boot. So, here's a close look at the pattern on the bottom. Closer look at the bindings. These are my all-time favorite bindings because I can use anything I want with them. They're heavy, but you're not restricted to the type of shoe or anything that you wear. If you want to take snowshoes with you, and say you're going on a long trip, pulling a folk sled or something, and when you're pulling the poke sled, sometimes you want to ski and sometimes you want to snowshoe. So, and you don't want to take a lot of weight with you because you, well, you got to drag it behind you or wear it on your back on a big trip. And I think most of y'all know that I do long-term backpacking. My longest backpacking trip, I was out in the wilderness for 5.5 months. Not days or weeks, but actually 5.5 months. My last biking trip was 2 months. And so I go out for quite a while. And what's nice about these is that with this type of binding, I don't have to carry a boot for skiing, a boot for snowshoeing, and a boot for walking around in. I can carry one boot, and this binding here will allow me to do this. With that one boot, I can snowshoe, I can ski, or I can walk around or whatever. So here it is with a boot installed, what it looks like. Yeah. Pretty cool. So, later this week, I intended to go out. We're supposed to have a big snowstorm tonight or tomorrow, if the news is correct. And once the snow hits, so we got some fresh powder out there, I'll go out and take some pictures and some video of me using these skis. I'll post a blog on my website and on Steemit showing me using the cross-country skis versus the backcountry skis versus my Yupis. This is the main reason for the show tonight. These are called Yupis, or there's another name for them, a more proper name for them, but the term that my friends and I have always called them were Yupis. These are made by Twin Dynastar. They are primarily downhill stunt skis, but I don't use them as downhill stunt skis. What I use them for is more of a snowshoe backcountry ski. It's basically the same thing as those Marquette backcountry skis there, only if I'm taking my dog with me and I want to like ski down the trails, I'll put my dog on a harness or something and I'll attach onto these and go zooming. The bindings that I have on here are bindings also that allow you, just like those bindings back there, these bindings allow you to use whatever shoe or boot you want to use. They just wrap up around your boot, and I'll put one in here in a minute to show you. And they wrap up around your boot, cinch it down in, any boot, any shoe you want. The only difference between this binding and that binding over there, as far as concept, is they don't rock. They don't rock back and forth like those do. Every bit of movement in your foot is translated to the ski board itself. So if you're going, they're basically designed so that you can go and do tricks and everything else. Now this binding here is not the original binding that goes with this. This binding was modified to work with this ski. This ski here is supposed to be used with a downhill boot. And I don't want to wear a downhill boot because I'm not using these for downhill skiing. I use these for backcountry and going on trails in the backcountry, but not groomed trails, and having my dog pull me around. So I need full control of my foot, which this allows me to do, but I don't want to have that big bulky boots on. So just going to look real quick the comments. And blueberry duck. Never done cross country, but maybe one day I'd like to learn to telemark. And my wife and I were trying to telemark a few days ago and fell down a few times. We do a lot of cross country skiing when I was young. So let's put one of these boots in here Let's see. I'm gonna still want to add these boots here real quick. So you just kind of place it in there. It's got this, basically lace it up regular shoelaces, similar to that. And unfortunately, the only way to get your shoe in on and off is to unlace it every time. So you can't just, like, once you have it laced up, leave it laced up. Because if you want to take your boot off or your foot out, you have to unlace it. These bindings were originally for snowshoes, but everything could be repurposed. They're really old school too. So even went right down to the type of buckle they use right there. Kind of like the claw buckle. And then you got the one in the back here. Now, so that's basically it there. You get full control. Alrighty, now what I need to do is tonight is I got to clean the old wax off of these because I haven't used them. I used to live up here in the upper peninsula of Michigan. But in 2013, I moved down to Pennsylvania. And while we were living in Pennsylvania, we never had any snow. The most snow we ever got at once was about 6 inches, and it only lasted for about a day or two, and then it was gone. So we didn't never really had a chance to do anything with it. And so all of our skis stayed in storage, and I didn't think about it, but I never cleaned the wax off of these. And if I want to use them now, I'm gonna have to clean all this old wax here and this all this brown stuff you see here. So you put the wax on, you kind of have to get a nice hard scraper, and you have to scrape off all the excess wax that you can, and then you have to apply a remover, a gel clean wax remover spray, which is this stuff. And this can here costs $15 or $14.95 plus tax. You gotta shake it up, spray it on, let it sit, and it kind of dissolves and works into the wax. And then you take your scraper again and you clean it off with some rags and stuff. So that's what we're gonna do tonight. Let's see how well that works. I've never used a wax remover before. So I don't know how well this is gonna work. But my scraper works great. My scraper is not actually for skis. It's for scraping the ice off of your car window. But it has so many great uses. So. All righty. Just about got that. Let's see if I can scrape some more off on this one. I think that's about all I'm gonna get off. So let's see about this stuff. This is a Swiss made Togo, Togo, Gel Clean Wax Remover Spray, HC3. See, it's got English. Getting old, gotta take the glasses off to read. It's got all the hazard stuff on it, beware. But no directions for use, so. One, scrape off, two, spray, three, scrape again, four, wipe. Wait minimum 10 minutes before waxing. Okay. Doesn't really say how much to spray on here. But. Doesn't say anything about letting it wait, so. Oh, yeah. That eats it right up. Melts it right away. Turns into like a little, like a gel. Yeah, can you bring me a roll? Wow, that is easy. I probably sprayed a little too much on it. Try a little less on it next time.
I'm bringing you some plants. I don't know if this is great.
Let's see here. I'm amazed at how well that worked.
Well, the place we got that spray wasn't gonna be crap.
Yeah. I get all my gear, basically every bit of my ski gear came from Downwind Sports in Marquette, Michigan. And they're really good people, I like them a lot. They always give me a really good deal. And they always, as far as I know, they've always treated people really good. So, well, that was super easy. I'm going to show you the difference here with the other one. Okay, so there's the clean one now. There's the dirty one that I haven't done yet. So there's the difference between them. Big difference.
Ooh. Nice.
Yeah, this is like, I'm not going to say this is like brand new, because it's old and scratched up, but as far as the wax is concerned.
Right. That's nice. It's back to the, like, the plastic surface or whatever. Yeah. It's, I can't remember if that's the word plastic applies or if that's, it's not vinyl.
So, okay, this one, scrape off all the excess. We're supposed to wait a minimum of 10 minutes before applying any new wax. So we probably won't get new wax on the second one, but we can probably get new wax on the first one. What time is that? 7:53. So that was done about 2 minutes ago. So let's say 8:02, we can wax the other one. Hopefully the snow comes early and we can go do some skiing tomorrow. Yeah. But
yeah.
I don't think it will. It was bright and sunny today, and didn't give any inclination of snow.
Every time I see the weather, it looks like it's going to be different. What they say. Oh, did you show them your boots and stuff yet?
Yeah, you can show them your boots. Okay. No, I haven't shown them your boots or your skis yet.
Let me put the ice pack back on my
foot. You could probably give more detail about the boots and stuff and the different types of pins.
Okay. Have you given them the disclaimer of where I learned all of my stuff?
No.
Okay.
I did tell them that I don't know anything about what I'm talking about. I'm just explaining my skis. Just my skis. And what I use them for, and what I'm doing.
Okay. So, I grew up in a family...
You want to come over here?
They don't have to watch me put my ice pack on, do they?
Well, I'm sure they all want to see you.
Okay. So, then we'll explain the ice pack.
So they can see your knee.
No, the knee isn't what I'm looking for. I'm trying to aim my foot. This is my left foot. As we can see, there's a lump where there shouldn't be. This is because I haven't dealt with my Achilles tendonitis since Doc got back from the Appalachian Trail. It was mostly in the left leg. I literally did a marathon and a 25K and a bunch of 5Ks and stuff. And it just bothers me in the morning generally. But I've decided I should probably do something about it. And then Doc was like, "You're on jogging moratorium for 3 months." And I'm like gnawing my leg off, kind of. So
yeah, I told her she wasn't allowed to run until her heel healed up.
Right.
And then she didn't listen to me, and she's still out jogging and stuff. And
so then basically in December, it's kind of getting better, and I've tried a couple of the different exercises. I'm just really bad at doing every day, do these exercises, because fiddly little exercises drive me nuts. So what I'm doing now is resting it somewhat, although this cross-country skiing motion shouldn't aggravate it too much. I tried doing some. And I don't know what it's called, but it's not, it's a different motion. It's more like a rollerblading motion with your feet. And I've never been able to do it properly. I've always wanted to. I don't know if it's Nordic or some other style. I could look it up, but I haven't. Whiffy. That's Whiffy. I'm glad I brought the plants in. Anyways.
I think it's got like the petroleum in it, like white gas.
It's got all sorts of weird stuff in it. And that's definitely, I'm excited that we have plants in here to help take care of that.
Yeah.
Wrong, but anyways, so the skiing we did yesterday, I did a little too much of experimental skiing, and I twisted my right ankle a little bit. So I've been icing the crap out of the tendons. And unfortunately, the right foot is now developing a small bump. I'm hoping that I can be careful and nip this in the bud before it gets both feet. The right foot's been kind of angry because I've been, I think the word is compensating, where you have an injury on one side, so you're kind of laying off on that side and using the other side more to take care of doing what you gotta do, and then that stresses it more than it usually is. So, good news, up until yesterday, though, I was doing a lot better. I just have to be more careful in what I do try to do. So, that's the ice pack. I will go get my boots in a minute, but I grew up with, I cross-country skied off and on, very recreationally, very cheaply for most of my life. And at the level that I do it, if you've read the blog on it, on his team, it's basically, hey, these skis work to get me from here to there, I'm having fun, I'm not dumping a bajillion dollars into it. But I don't have to. So I have old school. I mean, they're not completely old school binding. They're older than this binding for sure.
Nice and clean now.
Ooh, shiny. Did you show them my skis or any of the skis?
Now I can read it properly.
Ooh, right side up?
Yeah.
That's more fun. Have you showed them the bindings or anything yet?
No, your stuff.
Okay. No. So my bindings are 3-pin bindings, which is a really original name because the bindings have 3 pins in them. And then you just do that, and it locks down on the boot. I'll show you the boot in a second. You do this, and it pushes up, and it's off again. So there's not a whole lot of... It's locked in there some, but the boot is a lot less streamlined than some of the newer ones. I keep shaking it for emphasis, which is stupid. And it just has a little bit back here to kind of keep your foot from going sideways. When I started out, these were all over the place in Goodwill and thrift stores, and the boots were quite often you'd find in places, or the places that we would go, we could get them, like, sporting goods stores. People would be, like, keeping up with the Joneses, and this year or next year's, you know, new model of ski boots. They bring in their old ones, and, you know, you could get last year or the year before's model very, cheaply. And so that's what we do. You're right back with my ski
boots. And in a minimum of 3 more minutes, we can wax this one. So, I guess tuck a post office behind you. I could leave the same thing. The guy took 5 seconds to hand me my package that sent to secondary waiting for some reason. Honey Badger, they know you.
Well, yeah.
They're afraid that you might have the happy birthday virus or something.
Oh my gosh, get out of town. I had the ones from one of the videos, the spare ones, in a bag, and it was the bag I could find at the time when we were cleaning up, and that happened to be a dog poo bag, like empty. And I'm like, well, I have this. It's a bag. And because I've been trying to refill the little canister, pulled a bag off to get it started, and I was like, well, I can't shove this back in there. Put it on my desk. Looked at my desk when I needed a bag. I was like, bag, put it in there. And then this morning I went to, like, look at the desk. I'm like, this desk is really untidy. What's on here I don't need? Oh, hey, look, a dog poo bag. I'll put that in my pocket because I'm going to walk the dogs. Went to get the dog stuff. So I stuffed my hand into the bag, don't feel anything in there, you know, do the thing, grab it, turn it inside out, and then it drops happy birthday virus all over the road. I'm like, ah! So I'm like tying the bag off and picking up the little, yeah. So it still haunts us. Anyways, did you have more spiel?
No, I gotta wait a few more minutes before I can put the wax on.
So this is my 3-pin boot binding. Let's see if I can get my head to stop the sun or the light so much. And as you can see, it has little 3 holes where the pins on that binding, this sets in there. And then the top kind of mousetrap's actually almost on it.
Yeah, I'll get it away so you can show them.
Without hitting in the face. So pins go in the hole, and I'm not sure if I have... Hey, I actually have a left shoe and a left binding. But... You slide the shoe in, this part smushes down on that kind of duck bill on the front, bloop, and that holds the boot on there. So you can flex some, and your weight would keep this down, and you move forwards, you know, by skiing. Older stuff. You can find these skis. I'm seeing one or two of them with this kind of binding in thrift stores lately, but not so much, because since I wasn't really doing a lot of skiing down in Pennsylvania,
that's why this binding is the best.
It's nice.
Because
multi-purpose.
Any boot you want, don't matter. Any ski you want.
Yeah, as long as it fits in there, it doesn't have to be a particular kind, it just has to size-wise fit.
Yeah.
Have you shown them yours some?
No, I showed them my ski and how the boot clips in, but I didn't explain it to them.
Okay, well, I'll just show for comparison. This is the bottom of my ski boot. That's the bottom of his. And a lot of different bindings have different ridge styles going along the bottom and what they, like, land on and kind of clasp almost on the ski. So his bindings are, I don't know if that's the new normal blah, blah, blah or something.
Toe clip.
But, yeah. This style of one is one that you could buy. He got these this year. So this is still current. Between my 3 pins and this style is a style with 1 clip and a 1 line down the bottom, a style with 2 pins and a line down the bottom, and I think there's another style like this that has 1 line down. I don't know. I think this is at least 2 or 3 evolutions of binding since mine. So these are starting to be seen in thrift stores, and there's other ones that are in thrift stores now too. So if you're gonna get stuff at thrift stores to see if you like it, I recommend making sure you either get it all at once or see what you're seeing a lot of. Try to find boots for that, or try to find cheap newish skis and get the boots, because bindings are a lot easier to transfer around and you're less likely to find a boot in your size and in your binding style than you are to go and find a ski that you can transfer the binding on.
If that makes sense. I'll show you. You can see that there is a gap between the boards here.
Bell-shaped.
They kind of touch here and here. So between here and here, there, right about there, there's a gap between them. So in that arch way on your board, that's where you want to wax, depending on how much grip you want and how much glide you want and how much grip you want. So if I was going to use these strictly for the downhill tricks that they're designed for, probably only wax right where the boot goes. But I'm not going to be going downhill doing stunts. I'm going to be using them more like snowshoes cross country with my dog pulling me. So I'm going to go somewhere between the full length and here. So what I used to have was the full length of the arch when I was learning how to use them. But I think I'm a little bit better on them now. So I think I'm going to go about halfway, a little bit past the heel and the toe.
More slidey.
So I have more slide and make it easier for Kyle Dog to pull me. And then but at the same time, have some grip when I want to walk. So.
Have you explained the bottom of my skis and your skis?
I showed them.
You showed them
my
the fish
skis
tails?
Were the fishtails and
okay.
were waxless. So they actually have scales on the bottoms that do what the wax does. It'd be awesome if these had scales, but downhills don't, I don't think, come
I'm
with scales.
I'm not sure. I honestly don't enjoy downhill skiing. I like skiing downhills in a cross-country setting. I don't enjoy the thought of, like, getting all in. That stuff is even more restrictive to your movement.
I don't know how to stop. Yeah. So, and I don't know how to turn, really. So, unless, like, with cross-country skiing, where you're on a groomed trail, I can turn just fine.
You follow the groove.
You follow a groove and you're good. But with a downhill, you just pick your path and your lane and go. And I don't know how
to
stop.
Steer.
So when I hit the bottom of the hill, I just keep going. So.
And there generally aren't like little cables for you to grab and foam being sprayed on you. And.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I was just going to, actually, I forgot what I was going to point out. Oh, well, yeah, you've seen the scales on the bottom of them, but also showing them that most skis for the cross country, as far as I know, are that slightly bowed up in the middle, so that when you put your weight on them, the little fish scales will grab kind of like a snake belly, and you'll be able to get traction to push backwards. But at the same time, since your weight is on this one, your other ski is up a little bit, so that this isn't grabbing and you're able to sploosh forwards on it. So on a waxed ski, you're able to control how much wax you put on it and fine tune. On a waxless, you don't have to mess with it.
Hey, for applying the wax, there's you're going to rub the wax on with the container that the wax comes in, but then you need to like smooth it all out. And the best way to do that is with a cork. And so I got a Toco wax cork today, which was a whopping $8.50 for a piece of cork.
But it ought to last you a while, and it's natural cork. They were out of the artificial. I don't know if artificial is cheaper or more expensive or what the advantage is, but it looks a lot like the ones the ladies were using when we were talking about them.
I don't know, because it's all shapes. I don't know what edge or anything you use.
I would assume that you use whatever edge you need, but probably the logo goes up.
Yeah, so I'm going to just use this curved edge right here, the curved side.
It literally does not
fit. And just rub it in. Yeah, the groove fits nicely in your thumb.
Or it might fit in your fingers.
And so
too.
I go, just rub it on in. That feels right.
It does seem to have a 90 degree and a
a beveled.
These are beveled.
They're both beveled?
All four sides
okay.
here are beveled. The 90s
okay.
are up here.
I would say the beveled is the bottom and the 90s are the
yeah.
top.
I think that grooves for holding your hand.
This is the blonde leading the blonde.
Normally, whenever I've waxed these before, I just took the bottle of wax and rubbed
smooth.
It on and then left it. I didn't smooth it out or anything. I just went with it. But this wax is V40 Blue Extra Swix right here.
Swix is a big brand in terms of skiing. I've heard of Swix.
And I don't know how much it was. There was no price tag on it. But when I purchased this, which was $15, and this, which was $8.50, when you add this to it, it came out to $30.
$15, okay.
So
that's bucks. Well, no, sorry.
So this is about $10. Plus, it was actually closer to $50, but I got a 10% military discount. So this was probably around $10, $15. So... Well, actually, hey, I've got the receipt right here.
I think it was $38.
Yeah.
But
that was it was $30.09 after the military discount.
Put some elbow grease on that.
It was.
He wants
Port
to
Thermo. Okay. This was $8.46 after discount. So I don't know what it is before discount, but they give me 10% off. So just add 10% to 846. So, all right. So you got this little hook thing here on the lid.
This is out of my comfort zone.
It.
I have never used wax skis.
And you got this little
nub
right there on the aluminum.
Is it like a push property can?
It's kind of like a sardine can. You got the key, and you stick it on there.
Oh, you roll it.
And
did they actually
it.
Tell you at all? Oh, ingenious.
Yeah. It's not ingenious because I don't know.
Do you want me to try to do it? I think I understand the motion involved. So,
yeah,
it's like
you
those wax crayons.
With Parkinson's, I'm sitting here shaking.
Okay.
And I can't get it to stay on correctly.
There's a little bit of a picture on here that tells us poke it with the thing and then turn it. If it makes any sense, that's literally the lid. They show you the lid and then poke it on there and then turn it. There we go. Okay. I think once you've cut it open, then you can start like.
Hello,
peeling it.
Tom Nagy and, Dr. Feelgood was in here. Same person.
There's
Ooster Self Storage.
Wait, why?
Raw Pride, Honey Badger. Misty Dive Crew.
This is metal. This is a metal little thing, by the way.
Yeah, it's aluminum.
And it tore off in a little shred already, and I'm trying to make it.
Yeah.
I'm inept.
Yeah, we'll just go the other way. Where's the lid?
Lid. I can't get it to roll in a very tidy little thing. What I can do is like tear it off like a wax pencil. I have it started with a tear, but I'm assuming. Because you don't
maybe
want to scratch the bottom of your.
I'm gonna get a pair of pliers.
I'm gonna keep trying.
But don't break it off so that I don't have anything to tear without the pliers. But the cap doesn't want to hold on too well.
Maybe we're doing it wrong.
I'm doing it just.
This
the
is the
said.
Experimental version of learning here. So if there's
my old bottle of wax.
Was
push all pop. You did was a push. It was just like a push pop. You pushed it up from the bottom, and it worked just fine.
It's definitely wet, goopy, sticky.
Let me go up here.
It's very. It's currently pretty soft. It's not like wet soft, but this is designed to be effective at the temperature range we've described. I think it was like around 30 degrees. Yeah, -3 to what? That's Celsius. What the heck? Oh, I think that's snow and ice, probably, at different degrees. And they do it in Celsius. New snow. Oh, they tell you a new snow, 30 degrees to 19 degrees Fahrenheit, or old snow, 27 to 12. And they actually show it to you with, like, a little icon of a fresh-looking snowflake and one that looks more like a screwdriver head that's not a Phillips. It's that other one where it's more weird-shaped. But almost like a rounded little
Hex screw. No, my thumbnail's doing really good from the inside right now. Here we go, here we go. Ow, ow, stabbing, ow. No stabbing.
Here.
Hang on, no, we're good. Not my nostril. I don't need to pluck my nose hair yet. Oh, well, that was the end of that. I've managed to shred off little bits of it. And I found it describes on their new snow and old snow. Do we have a trash bag? We do. Where did you put the trash bag? I have a bag for the trash.
Well, it's magnetic.
What? But it's not aluminum.
Apparently.
So you're rolling it in the motion that I was hoping to achieve. So apparently next time you want to put wax on your skis things, you're going to want to use... That looks better. That's a lot tidier than mine. Still, where's the trash bag? I want to get rid of the waxy goopy
stuff. In the bathroom.
How did it get there? Can I reach it?
I put it with the other trash.
Tidy. Why did it want to be tidy when I was going to need it? Cantilever? No, I don't think that's quite the term for that. Or camber. The word is camber. Is that arch kind of thing?
There we go. Alrighty.
And then maybe you can get the little nub thing on your on the wax cap to fit into that little rounded thing.
Oh, the temperature range for this is 1 degree Celsius.
I just told him.
You did?
Yeah, I was killing time while you were gone.
All right, well then never mind. Screw y'all.
No, they don't get to do that. That's my job. Ew. Throwing it from, like, 5 feet away is not getting it in the trash. I just don't feel like standing up today. Worse. So this is definitely a lot harder than the stuff that the people were at the warming station yesterday. The warming hut. We asked some people that looked a little more ski savvy.
Whoa. Now about I gotta rub it in. I think the rub it just cork kind of massages and heats it up. And
yeah, the friction probably does smooth it in there. And then the cork, it has pores where little bits of it can get kind of gooped into and spread around to where there isn't stuff. I know Mom and Dad used to keep their wax in the freezer. They knew a little more.
Maybe they didn't want it to melt over summer.
Right, make a nastiness. And it's probably, you know, when I was a kid, that's 20-something years ago to even longer. So they've probably gotten new wax polymers and stuff. Cool.
All right. I don't know if you're going to see that.
Not really, unless I start... Like,
I think you can see the shine on there.
You kind of can. It's more of a tactile difference. The stuff they were using was really soft. This kind of reminds me of using a crayon that like a really young kid has been used before you. And since instead of drawing with it at an angle so it maintains at least some of a point, they just... like 90 degrees to the paper and like shred, so then you have a flat surface of crayon up to where the paper stops them from going any farther, and you have to rip some of the crayon paper off.
All right, there we go. That is one down. 10 more to go.
Raw Pride likes downhill skiing. I've never really wanted to try it. I'd rather just like hustle my butt up a little hill and then ski down it and go, yay, I survived.
If everybody could do me a favor, my buddy Raw Pride is trying to make $1 million. And he made a wish today or a request today for $1 million. And so I don't have $1 million to give him, but I sent him 2 Steam. And if anybody's on Steam it, they can go over to @RawPride and give him a thumbs up on his latest post or something, or send him some little bit of steam. Help him reach that $1 million. Tell him Doc sent you.
Is that like the key that gets you into the party?
Maybe.
Knock, knock. Doc sent me. Oh, you can come in.
Yeah.
The bouncer's gonna like look out with one eye through the little crack in the door and be like, "Are you cool?"
Yeah.
Yay.
What's that?
Haha, you're the best at you. Aw, he sent something squidgy. Very squee. I should probably stretch before I do stuff like this. The skiing, which is one of my other reasons I probably have been injured, is I was doing a lot of not wearing much heel lift shoes and very little between me and the road. Mm-hmm. So my calves were getting really strong, which meant I wasn't stretching them at all. So they passed the tension on to the Achilles tendon.
Let's see here. I'm pretty sure I mentioned this earlier. We're no experts or anything.
No joke.
We're just like, just go out and do it for fun. Okay, I think that's good. We just go out and do it for fun. I'm just showing you what stuff I have and what I do. So.
After you wax, somebody else wants you to wax their car.
Wants me to what?
Somebody wants you to wax their car after you're done.
If you get a bunch of girls out there, sexy girls wearing bikinis and showing off their bodies while I wax your car, then sure. Otherwise, I don't think that's going to happen. So.
Rob Pride is on the ball today.
All
right. Dive was here for a while, it looked like.
Yeah. So.
Yay.
To recap real quick,
that's a ski.
These are for, I use these irregardless of why they were made. The reason I use them is for cross country, on and off trail with my dog, in areas that are would be more of a snowshoeing area because they're wide and they glide and float like snowshoes, but at the same time I can slip and slide and get some speed up. And then I use these for my cross countries on groomed trails.
I think those are touring ones versus,
yeah.
Like those are ones for doing longer trips and potentially maybe handle a little more off groomed trail because they're a little wider than these.
I've gone on a 12-day long midwinter trip in negative 14 degree temperature with these skis. That's the trip that my scholarship purchased the ski set for me for. And we went out for 12 days in the Sylvania wilderness at negative 14 degree temperatures. And there's actually only maybe 8 to 10 inches of snow on the ground at the time. We went over lakes, through the woods, all kinds of terrain and stuff. And that's really when I learned how to ski. What I learned on this very ski right here during that 12-day period. And so these are cool. And then, of course, my Marquette backcountry skis, which I use for in the trails, going through the woods. If I was going to go on a long-term backpacking trip in the winter, I would probably take these and for the deep snow and a pair of snowshoes.
Those are heavy though.
Yeah.
From what I've looked at them on.
Yeah, these are heavy. So these would be used for in the areas where I have flat land or some downhill and deep, deep snow, which is around here, you get that. And so I'd use these for that, pulling a Polk sled. Because of the weight, the size of them, they're really great for pulling a Polk sled with all your camping gear in. And they can support more weight if you're wearing a backpack and stuff.
But you don't want to have to be lifting your feet up and stepping up like a snowshoe. Because
that's
a lot of, like,
and if you're wearing snowshoes and trying to pull a Polk sled behind you, picking up and walking the whole time will really wear you out. Where these, you don't have to pick your feet up. You can scoot yourself forward. Like, you can't scoot yourself on snowshoes. But with the grip on the bottom of those, scooting yourself forward, you still be able to maintain pulling that sled behind you. So, pretty nice. So.
I couldn't see your scoot motion.
I am. Where did the lid go?
Here's the lid.
Okay.
It has three little pokes on the top. I think that's the scab end. It just kind of stick. That works.
I think next time I'm going to get the other brand that is the push pop version like I used to have, just simply because it's easier to use. Although I probably won't be buying another bottle for until
years.
I use this one.
Yeah. I wonder how many people actually run out of wax versus, crap, where did that one go?
Yeah.
Like pencils.
So I think I'll probably die before this is all used up anyway. Alright. I am very happy with this. And
wait 10 minutes before waxing.
Yeah. Totally. Literally, it doesn't have any written instructions that I can see other than don't eat and kill yourself with it. But it's just got pictures for instructions if you want.
Because it's in German. Maybe that's just warnings in German and French. And English. Okay, English is under the German. May cause drowsiness or dizziness, harmful to aquatic life with long-lasting effects. Extremely flammable aerosol pressurized container may burst if heated. If medical advice is needed, have product container label at hand.
Hey, Sally.
Don't give it to kids.
How are you doing?
Don't put it in the stove.
Came in at the end of the show. We've already gone over all the skis and stuff, but glad to see you there.
Don't spray it on an open flame.
Yeah. Well, if you need a blowtorch, you know, you're good to go.
Don't cloak it even after use. Don't breathe the vapor or the spray. Mm-hmm. Use outdoors in a well-ventilated area.
Misty, don't ask for things you can't handle.
I don't want to know what she's asking for.
When are you coming back to PA so we can go out to dinner again? Actually, it's either going to be April, mid-April, or the beginning of May. Tom, I'm shooting for the second week of April is the goal, and I'm gonna I plan on keeping in contact with you so that you can let us know what the weather's like, because I need
inside information.
Yeah, because when we go down there, we're gonna need to do some yard work and a little cleanup, like we usually have to after winter.
It's aerodynamic.
And we don't want to be rocking around in snow and stuff, so.
No. If you do it, you have to cross at the ankles. That's more ladylike. There, that's.
Yeah, I can go put a skirt on. That's as far as it goes. Maybe I can get this other leg over higher.
Okay, well, changing the subject. This has German, French, English, Italian warnings. And then you know how like on some of those bottles, like pills, you can peel off the label and you see the more directions on the back. It also has NO, Norwegian maybe, SE's potentially Swedish, FI, I'm pretty sure it's Finnish, Japanese, Czech, Polish, and Russian warnings on the back of the label, just in case they sell it.
But no directions, because there's not enough room to put directions in all those different languages, so they just give you pictures.
Well, it's pretty explanatory. Scrape it, spray it, scrape it again, and wipe it. End of story.
Can you hand it to me?
You want the bottle?
Yes, so I can put it up with the rest of the stuff. Kind of like, I won't say it on the
thing. I was totally not going to say it either. It does look very aerodynamic. Like, if you threw it, it would be like, whoosh, 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 whoosh.
Yeah. Misty might know what we're talking about.
Most people that know you and your mind would know what they're talking about. Whatever.
Alrighty. Is there anything else you want to say?
My ski costs $12.99.
I noticed here earlier that I never took the sticker off of these skis. And even though these are 8 years old, still got the price tag on the bottom of them. Well, they were $189.
You don't scrape them very much. Well, if we're going to play the price tag game, check
this. These skis right here were $189 when I got them.
But they didn't come with binding. Binding and stuff.
The bindings were $10 because they were...
Because an acquaintance was...
Yeah, a friend of mine had them just... A friend of mine worked at Downwind Sports, and they just had them, found them by accident, just sitting up in the storage room. And they're like, well, hey, would you like these? You can use any good with them. And I say, okay, sure.
Yes.
Like, well, here, just we got to give you some price on them. They had to put something down or write them off as stolen. So instead of writing them off as stolen, they charged me $10 for them and wrote them off as a used item.
So Norway is big on – Norway, Sweden, Finland are big on skiing because a lot of the gear is made in or Swiss. This, my bindings are made in Norway. Rosignol, I think, is French, judging from the French-looking flag colors on the rooster. And it says made in France on the bottom where it called
it
fiber or whatever. Did not, and I didn't even knock any plants over yet.
Yeah, you brushed my hair, though.
You duck faster. You live with me long enough to know that you have to duck. Mine still has the price tag on it, too. When I got this, I've had these before we went to Pennsylvania. A long time before. I paid $12.99, unless that was the color of the week. And it might have been half off. And then we had to get new boots for me because down in Pennsylvania, we never got a chance to ski, and I didn't get them moving around enough.
So they kind of got trashed in storage.
They got between moldy, manky, and most poopy done, and you're like, ew. So then
you
I had the
shoes in storage, in long-term storage. They don't tend to work very well.
Not the way we stored them, apparently. So then these precious items, remember how old I was talking about this binding system is? They don't literally sell them at the two stores, the sporting goods stores we have here. These are like defunct binding boot thing. So we tried three more thrift stores. At the third one, I not only found three-pin bindings or three-pin boots like I needed for the skis I already owned, but I found them in my size. And freaking, like, all of the wear you see on them, I have put on in the last couple times we've used them.
So they were basically brand new.
They were freaking new. Like, white lace. The puffy stuff inside was still puffy. I've smushed it down a little bit. And I paid $9.99 for them. I had to get the person to price them at Goodwill because me trying on the boot knocked the price tag off. And I was like, oh, they won't sell them if they don't have a price. And these are the only ones probably on the continent. And I'm like... Can you please put a price on these? And so they took them back and priced them. So, yay. Those make me giggle because of the ridiculousness of them.
Right. Oh, I never showed my ski poles.
Right. Well, that worked. Well, right back up. If I did it, I would, like, rip it in half. He's got some topics.
Really...
Tall
long
person, long pole.
Poles.
Depending on what you're doing, the length of your pole will be slightly different. I think those are more for backcountry touring kind of thing at that length for you.
Yeah. They're one-way diamond, 600s. They are 155
centimeters probably.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff in skis is done in metric. Because I think a lot of the countries that are main...
They come up to my chin, which you can't really see
but
you're supposed to ski back here. So they go slightly off to the side so that you're not digging into the groom. And your hand's down by your hips.
Yeah.
And so you
no
got control.
Frankenstein.
And you get the long strides going with you. So... The cups?
Or baskets.
Baskets. Can you use these for backpacking in the summertime?
I would not.
You could, but they are too long. They're not strong enough for backpacking poles, and they're way too big and too long for backpacking poles. But, I mean, if you didn't have any other choice, you could, or you want to look like you're walking with a staff, maybe, but... These are ski poles, not backpacking poles.
They're not checker poles. I couldn't find my hiking poles. I hate hiking with poles.
They have a real nice
stabby.
Sharp, stabby thing. So if you got to fight off a Troivian or a bear or something, there you go.
Well, you're more likely to see a bear than a troll.
I said Troivian.
I know. I'm just thinking in terms of what likely you're going to see. I'm not skiing with trolls right now because I'm lazy.
All right. That's about all we got. That actually looks like... yeah.
His weed whacker had...
Yeah. So...
Oh, yeah. Okay, I get it.
Okay, so... Blunt that's instrument. Basically what we have. Thanks for going by, stopping by, saying hello, hanging out. And...
Your fun's hanging out.
Yeah.
Or maybe it was fun hanging out with you. Check your pockets. Nothing's hanging out.
No.
That one's good. No fun hanging out.
Okay. So we'll do as soon as we get another snow, I'm going to go out and I'll make a video of me using the Yuppies, the little orange ones. Make a video of me using the Marquette Backcountry ones. We've already got videos of me using the Cross Country, but I'll make a blog with video clips of each one so you can see how we use them in video form, actually out in use. And we'll post that on Steam It and my website, WordPress, fixedbydoc.com. So, and we'll probably post the individual videos on YouTube as well here.
But, yay. People enjoy being here.
Always
that's
a pleasure
tough.
To hang out with you guys.
How
you
having me.
All right, well, thanks for watching, and we'll talk to you all later.
Have a good evening or day or whenever you watch this.
Yeah. 3, 2, 1.